thank you. This is a very home-like place. We're always happy in common ground that in 1975 we started talking about interreligious dialogue, and then I realized the Theosophical Society started that in 1875. So we're the latecomers, but we're in the same family, so thank you. I'm going to be talking about a book I'm working on right now on the letter of James in the New Testament. It's a relatively small letter, fairly neglected, so why have I picked it? Well, the biggest thing going on in the study of the Christian Testament today and of early Christian history is the realization that Christianity, the Christian movement, the Jesus movement, was extraordinarily diverse in its beginnings. The last 60 years or so, the sands of Egypt keep turning up books that show us new gospels, new texts, new ideas. Why is that important? I think prior to that, the ordinary understanding was that Christianity had a pretty clear origin. I mean, there were a few heretics, a few people who got it wrong, but for the most part, there was a clear consensus about where the center was. Now we realize that that is no longer a hypothesis we can start from. We realize that Paul, who really became the voice of Christianity, because those were the earliest writings in the Christian Testament, his letters are from the 50s, the majority of the 27 books are attributed to him, his influence is clear in almost all the other books, and Paul just became the voice of Christianity. And now there's a shift and an understanding that Paul is certainly a voice of Christianity, but he was not the voice. He became the voice by getting rid of a lot of other voices. And there's an interest today in exploring those voices. That is, there's an interest in some places, because forms of Christianity that are pretty much settled on what's in and what's out don't want to consider those other voices. And this is part of what I've been working on for a while in my Gospel of Thomas book, for example, because that's not in the Christian Testament. But why then in the letter of James book, which is? Because although the letter of James book is in the Christian Testament, it's among the 27 books, we call these the canon or canonical. So when I talk about something being canonical, it's official. Canon is just the Greek word for a ruler, so it means the things that are officially there. I think a lot of Christians think Christianity had this New Testament, Christian Testament, from the beginning. That was not so. Different Christian communities had different books, different letters. There was no one collection of books. And when Constantine co-opted Christianity, and of course, there may be debate about the role of Constantine, see? In the Orthodox Church, he's a saint. I don't think he was. I don't think he was a Christian. Any historians I talk to who know that era don't think he was. He was a pretty ruthless climber to power and wanted to be the sole ruler. And he saw the Christians as a group seasoned by persecution and hardship in a rather corrupt society who could, if they supported him, I think, be a help to him in his move to power. Christians saw him as a pretty good deal because Christianity had been illegal from the edict of Nero in 64, when Nero had to blame the fire on someone, until 313. So for that entire time, to be a Christian was a capital offense. You didn't have to do anything. And ironically, you were charged in a Roman court for atheism because you denied the gods of Rome. So when Constantine came out with the Edict of Toleration in 313, he also stopped crucifixion as a means of capital punishment, and Christians felt understandably pretty good about this. And this began a process that we know as the gradual formation of a Holy Roman Empire, as it was called, we tend to say the empire was Christianized. Today, I think we're beginning to realize more Christianity was imperialized. Christianity became an empire. You see, in the teachings of Jesus, there's a clear contrast between the reign or the kingdom of God and the kingdom of Caesar. Part of the new scholarship about the Christian Testament is this new wave, we call it, has a greater emphasis on the sociological disciplines, the politics of it, the economy of it. And John Dominic Crossan, one of the scholars, said, when Jesus said the kingdom of God, he was saying, in effect, in your face, Caesar. Okay. And in my book on Paul, I'm reflecting on the fact, why does Paul want his Christians to say with their lips, to say out loud, Jesus is Lord? Because the society said, Caesar is Lord. And so ultimately, life is about where we choose to put our loyalties. Paul Tillich is one of my favorite theologians. He was teaching in the German university system. He was from a very prestigious Prussian family. He already had a reputation in his 40s. And he publicly said, I can't be a Nazi because I already have a Führer, a leader, Jesus Christ. And the Nazis couldn't afford to arrest him, let alone kill him, so they put him on a boat for the United States, where he spent the remainder of his career. But you see, he was the first non-Jewish professor to be expelled from a German university because he saw what was at stake. See, where do you put your loyalty? And what Jesus preached was the basic message of the prophets of Israel, the basic message of the Quran, and that is, I usually put it in these four principles, see? God is supreme. Peace comes from justice. The prophet Isaiah said, peace is the fruit of justice. Justice is fairness. Generally, when people feel that they're being treated fairly, they're open to peace. Third, your value is your relationships. The most important word in the Bible is covenant. In Latin, that word is testamentum. So Christians divided their Bible into an old covenant and a new covenant. A covenant is a relationship. And so from the biblical perspective, the Hebrew Bible, Jesus, the Quran, our value, if I could put this grammatically, is not our nouns, but our prepositions. The New Yorker had a cartoon of a guy in his driveway with his cars and yachts and all of this. Those are nouns, right? Nouns, things. Prepositions are the toughest things to learn when you learn a new language, because a preposition isn't like a podium or a table or a plant. It expresses a relationship. Okay? So the Bible is interested in your prepositions. Okay? What are you with? Okay? That's a preposition. God is revealed to Moses as the one who is with you. I think God is the great with of human experience. It was interesting when the new mayor was elected, you know, Chicago headline said, Mayor Emmanuel. Well, Emmanuel, in Matthew's gospel, it says Jesus will be called Emmanuel. That means God is with us. So I thought, Mayor, God is with us. We're in for a good time here, see? Well, Jesus was never literally called Emmanuel, see? But the last verses of Matthew's gospel, Jesus says, I will always be with you. That's Emmanuel, see? So what are we with? See? What are we without? What are we into? What are we over? What are we under? Hermann Hesse, one of my favorite writers, wrote a book, Unterm Rad, Under the Wheel. He had a nervous breakdown when he was in high school, and he writes a novel about this. Under the wheel, see? What are we under? So those are prepositions. See, how are we related? And the Bible says, your richness is the texture of relationships. My rabbi teacher at Northwestern said one day, from the viewpoint of the Bible, what's the greatest disaster? And, you know, we were all guessing war and plague and disease. He said, no, I said, to be without relations, see? Woe to the one who is alone. A rich life is a life richly textured with relations. Relations to God, to intimate others, to communities, to friends, to nature. And finally, what is our purpose? To serve. That's very clear. Israel is chosen not to dominate the world, but to be a source of spiritual teaching. Whenever Jesus talks about leadership, it's about service. Now let's go to the empire of Caesar, and really it's the protocol of any empire, okay? Any empire. Which is why ultimately I don't think there could ever be a Holy Roman Empire. I think that's an oxymoron. But how was it ever even dreamed of? Well, what's Caesar's empire like? The state is supreme. Okay? The goals of the state are supreme. The emperor is supreme. Okay? Christians wouldn't offer incense to the emperor. Paul's Christians said, Caesar is not Lord, Jesus is Lord. Tillich said, Hitler is not Lord, Jesus is my Lord. So that's the first thing. What is supreme? Rabbi Heschel said, God is either of supreme importance or of no importance. We can't tuck God in between tennis and volleyball somewhere. Either this is what it's all about or forget it. Peace, the Romans say, comes from conquest. The Roman motto was, si vis pacem, para bellum. If you want peace, get ready for war. So here was the largest empire the world had ever seen, 26 legions dominating that whole world around the Mediterranean. Through terror, you see? Terror. I mean, what was crucifixion all about, you see? When this streets leading to Jerusalem might have 200, 500 Jews crucified with a sign over the cross what they were crucified for. Right? Terror. Rome wanted you to know, don't mess with us. Right? When the Jews rebelled in 66, it just took two legions to take care of it. Right? So peace means you're able to beat down any opposition. And what are your values? Possessions. We're back to nouns. See? Every historian will tell you it wasn't those northern peoples who threatened Rome. They're often called barbarians, but since those are all my ancestors, I think of them as northern peoples. And de facto, don't think of them as savages running down. I mean, they moved because of food sources. They had wagons and so on, built homes. It was a sort of a gradual movement into the area. But that's not what destroyed Rome. It was something we never hear of in our country, an insatiable greed on the part of leaders who wanted more and more perks. And they were bleeding the provinces to get this money, and that's what brought Rome down. It's been pointed out that the mafia, as we see it today, is the residue of the Roman Empire. It ran the same way. It was a system of benefits. You got benefits from those below you, and you gave to those above you. And the name of the game was to get more than you have to give. I grew up, you know, near a very Italian neighborhood, and you could see the alderman walk down the street on a given day, go into every store, and come out with an envelope. And that was the money that kept your store safe. Okay? So it's a workable system. It's probably as good as any other. If I had a store, you know, giving $20 a month to somebody, Fine, hey? So you give money to those above you, and you get money from those below you. That's how the Roman Empire essentially ran. And the mafia has inherited that. It's, you know, nobody sat around and said, let's think of a new idea, the mafia. It was simply the empire drawn a little smaller. And what should be your attitude to others? Well, as a senior Latin student in high school, we read the Aeneid. And when I taught Latin, I taught the Aeneid. And the Aeneid is political propaganda for the emperor. And go back and look at old Aeneas, see? Again and again, he's told, your job is to conquer. The Romans felt their mandate was to conquer. The Jewish mandate, there's not a verb in the Bible that ever tells the Jews they're supposed to go out and conquer the world. They were to be the Or LaGoyim, the light to the Gentiles. Jerusalem was to be a city on the hill where people came for spiritual teaching. They were to be a blessing. They were chosen. That was their goal, say, to serve. Rome was chosen to dominate. That's how they understood their vocation. And they did. And they did. You know, as effectively as it had ever been done up until that time. Now, that's why Crossan said, see, I think many of us who grew up in churches and heard about the reign of God, the kingdom of God, never dreamed that it had any political significance. See? But when you put it in this kind of juxtaposition, you got the reign of God or you got the reign of Caesar. And they look like pretty clear alternatives. But then with Constantine, everything changed. Now that the empire is Christian, maybe it's okay to serve the empire. Maybe it's okay for the empire to pursue peace through war. Constantine said, most people are illiterate. How are they going to know about the greatness of Christianity? He sent his mother to Jerusalem, Helen, and said, start building big churches. Start having bishops live in palaces. The ordinary people are only going to understand the importance of Christianity if they see something. So if Christianity starts looking like an empire, people will get the idea. So we have Christian armies, Constantine claimed to have a vision, or Eusebius, his buddy who was bishop, told the story that on an eve of battle, he saw this vision of the cross and the words of Christ in this sign, you will conquer. I don't know how anyone can read the Gospels and believe that Jesus would have appeared to this power-hungry guy and tell him that he was going to conquer with the sword as a Christian task. But that sure got into the Christian consciousness, and we had crusades from the word crux, sword. And there is no debate among scholars of religion, and it always amuses me when people talk about Islam being violent. There is no debate among scholars of religion that Christianity has, by and large, been the most violent religion in our planetary history, far exceeding Islam. Muslim governments tended to be much more tolerant than Christian. The Jews of Europe would always do better under the Muslims than under the Christians. If you're in Istanbul, go to the Jewish Museum, and there's a letter from the Sultan written in 1492, when Ferdinand and Isabella decided to drive all the Jews from Spain, and the emperor said, your people of the book, that's what the Quran calls Jews and Christians, we're sorry for what's happening to you. You are welcome here in our empire. Come. And those Jews who could get there did, and there's 10 or 15 letters from rabbis thanking the Sultan, one of the only leaders to open doors to the Jews who are being driven from every Christian land. So, you know, I often thought, how did this happen, see? How did this happen? Because the empire became Christian. And when that happened, this whole clarity of division disappeared. And it's never been straightened out since. Oh, we have a few Christian groups I always think it's ironical, we call them peace churches to indicate that the majority of Christians are war churches. Right? Gandhi said, everybody knew Jesus taught nonviolence except the Christians. Isn't it strange we call a church a peace church as an unusual, bizarre, peripheral, eccentric group? What an odd group of Christians. They believe in peace. I mean, that's where things have gotten us, you know? So there's a lot of effort today to say, let's listen to those voices. Now, after looking at some of the Gospels not in the New Testament, I got curious about what is there. Now, one of the sharpest Christians to come down the pike was Martin Luther. And when Martin Luther was translating the Bible from Hebrew and Greek into German, he said, I would like to take the letters of James and Jude and the letter of Hebrews and throw them in the Elbe River. Luther was always mild in expressing his opinions. And in another place, he called James a letter of straw. He wanted to take them out of the New Testament and put them in an appendix. Why? Because Luther was very sharp, and he said, they don't agree with the gospel preached by Paul. Every other book of the New Testament preaches Paul except these three. And I always say, Luther was right, and he was wrong. He was right that they don't agree with Paul, but I think he was wrong to presume that Paul, who never met Jesus, but had mystical experiences of Jesus, knew Jesus better than his brother, James. James, and again, you know, the English translations have just ruined the Jewishness of the New Testament, which is why in my Matthew Gospel, you know, I call Jesus Yehoshua, Yeshu, Joseph is Yosef, and James is not somebody from Ireland, you know. The Greek word is Jacobus, he's Yaakov, he's Jacob. Okay? We're told in, first in Mark's Gospel, that, you know, Jesus had four brothers. Okay? And then they are, it's when he comes to his hometown synagogue and the people say, isn't this the carpenter, the son of Mary? By the way, this is the only verse in Scripture where Jesus is called a carpenter. Matthew says, he's a son of a carpenter. And a carpenter can either mean what we think of as a carpenter, so making furniture and stuff, or someone who did wood and stone work for the Roman builders. But at any rate, his townspeople say, isn't this the carpenter, the son of Mary? Now, it's odd to be called by your mother's name. That usually means you're a bastard. Well, that's something to puzzle for another day. And the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon, and are not his sisters here with us? So four brothers are named. Now, there are many ways of reading the Bible. If you read it from a feminist perspective, you might notice here what you'll notice in many places. The sisters are neither numbered nor named. That was very common. Women didn't count. And so here, four brothers are named, and there were some sisters. We don't know how many or what their names were. Now, Gospels that are not canonical say he had two sisters. One was named Mary and one Salome. And the Gospel of Philip has, which is not canonical, has that teasing little phrase, the three women closest to Jesus were all named Mary, his mother, his sister, and his companion, Mary Magdalene. And companion has all that ambiguity that it does in English. It's kind of like partner. You know? That could be the guy you run the store with or the guy you sleep with. It's kind of, or both, it's one of those ambiguous phrases. So you can take companion any way you want. But that's a story for another night. This is that James. Or at least, that's my conclusion. There's some debate about it. But I don't think the arguments against it being James are very strong. The biggest argument is His Greek is pretty good. Well, around 1972, a German scholar named Meyer wrote a book that turned New Testament scholarship upside down. Everybody thought that the Jews in Palestine wouldn't know Greek. Paul would, because, you know, he's from another province. But not Jesus. And now Meyer's work, which is good German scholarship, it has two volumes. The second volume is all footnotes. That's German scholarship. Meyer has proved, so that no one could argue with him, that Greek was known. What was the name, I'll do a little Bible quiz here, of Peter's brother, recall? Anybody? Andrew. That's not a Jewish name. That's a Greek name. Why did a Jewish fishing family name one of their kids Andrew? And if Jesus and maybe Joseph worked on these Roman building projects, what language did the foreman speak? The common language in the Roman Empire was Greek. That's just one of the many things the Mel Gibson movie gets wrong. Pontius Pilate would not have spoken Latin. Latin at that time was a local language in just a tiny area of Italy. The New Testament is written in what we call Koine Greek, common Greek. That was the language spoken throughout the Roman Empire. It went back to Alexander. And that's why when Christians published anything, they didn't publish it in Aramaic, the language of Jesus that he taught in. They published it in Greek. We have no Christian writings, not in Greek. A few Aramaic phrases are in there in the gospel, like Jesus heals a little girl and he says, Talitha cum, little girl, get up. But everything else is Greek. Well, many Jews spoke Greek or knew some Greek. And now scholars think Jesus probably did. If he worked on projects, he knew Greek. And when Roman officers come to talk to Jesus, they wouldn't have known Aramaic. We're never told there was an interpreter. Jesus probably understood enough Greek to talk to them. So now we get back to James. The letter's in Greek, pretty decent Greek. But it does have what scholars call Semitisms. What this means is, when you speak a second language, but you still have hints of your first. Since all my grandparents were German, I grew up with this. It wasn't until I learned German I understood why my grandparents spoke the way they did. My grandmother would say, make the door to, make the light out, wash your face off, that was the best one. And it used to be said that in Milwaukee, the streetcar went the corner around. Because German puts prepositions at the end. And in German, you say, macht das Licht aus. You say, I finally realized all the English my grandmother was speaking was just German with English words. So that's what a Semitism is. It's Greek, but you'd know that the person writing it had as their first language Aramaic. And that would fit James, Jacob, the brother of Jesus. Besides, he lived over 20 years in Jerusalem, and all the educated people in Jerusalem spoke Greek. So that's not a real objection, I don't think. And in the book, I'll go through all of these reasons, but the bottom line is, I see no convincing reason it wasn't written by James. But it doesn't agree with Paul. Now, why is this important? Because some Christians won't look at evidence if it's non-canonical. A friend of mine bought a copy of my Thomas book and gave it to a friend. She looked at it and gave it right back. Said, I don't want to read this. It's not in the New Testament. So with those folks, you're not going to get anywhere with the Gospel of Thomas. But they can't throw out James. And when you read James, you realize this is a different voice. It's a different voice. And oddly enough, since I'd written Matthew first, it sounds so much like Jesus. There are more of the teachings of Jesus in those five chapters of James than in all the letters of Paul put together. And what's interesting is, James doesn't quote Jesus. He doesn't say, as Jesus said. He just says what he says and happens to say the same kinds of things Jesus says. In other words, when you read James, if you know the teachings of Jesus, you just have this strange awareness, these two people really sound alike. Well, if they lived together from the time they were kids, they probably did. And if they were together, even during Jesus' ministry. And this is kind of a tricky issue. Sometimes current polemics are reflected in the way the story of Jesus is told. You probably know the big split in Islam was between those who felt that leadership should come from relatives of Muhammad and those who didn't. The majority are the Sunni, who don't think relationship means a lot. The Shia think it does. So if you see an Iranian cleric with a black turban, that means he's claiming to be a blood relative of Jesus. Most people don't know Christianity started out with the same argument. The Jerusalem church, which was the mother church, they had James, and when James died, they elected Simeon, who was a cousin of Jesus. On his father's side, which is interesting for those who would take virgin birth literally, because in that case, a cousin of Jesus on his father's side wouldn't be a relative. While it tells us the Jerusalem church didn't know anything about a virgin birth, at least not in a literal sense. So the Jerusalem church felt that relationship to Jesus was important. The rest of the churches didn't. And so when the gospel story is told, we get these strange confrontations of Jesus where his family comes to see him, and he seems rather abrupt and dismissive. And they, your mother and your brothers are here to see you. And he goes, who is my mother and my brothers? Those who do the will of God. I mean, it seems quite polemical. And yet, in the Gospel of John, at the wedding feast of Cana, we're told his brothers and his disciples were there, and they went to Capernaum with him afterwards, which was the center of his ministry during his three teaching years. Not Nazareth, where he lived, in his childhood, which was an inland city, but Capernaum, a sea on the north end of the Sea of Galilee. That was the headquarters of Jesus' public life or public ministry. And in the Acts of the Apostles, when they're gathered together to pray in the upper room, his brothers are there, his mother. So, and Paul says that the first one to whom Jesus appeared, well, maybe not the first, but among the first, was his brother, James, Jacob. So without a doubt today, the most important Christian in the early church was James. If you have any doubt of that, read the letter to Galatians, where Peter and Paul are up in Antioch, which was the second oldest church after Jerusalem. And they had a mixed community of Gentiles and Jews, and so they were lax about food laws and things like that. And then they're told that some of the people of James are coming. And Peter just about has a stress attack, as you can see him running around to make sure that the Jewish Christians aren't eating with the Gentile Christians and that the food is kosher. Well, why was Peter so nervous about James? And when Paul wants approval for his mission, he says he goes first to see Peter, but then ultimately James. Scholars think James was the head of the community. Peter was probably the head of what we might call a mission outreach committee. So Paul went to Peter first, but Acts is very clear. James says, we're allowing this to happen. And James was a remarkable person to have survived for almost 30 years in Jerusalem as the leader of a minority sect that was not particularly popular. Not only survive, but the Jewish historian Josephus says, James was very respected by Jewish leadership. And he's described by Hegesippus, whose books don't survive, but Eusebius had them, we don't. And Hegesippus describes James as a person of prayer who wore white, who prayed in the temple. He sounds a lot like an Essene. I think, Well, I actually think James, Jesus, and John the Baptist probably spent time with the Essenes. The Jerusalem church is the only church that shares their property. Paul's churches don't. And the Essene community shared its property. There's a lot of other things, but not to go into now. The big point is, Luther was right in knowing that something different is going on here. But maybe we need that different voice. See, this is the basic premise of all this stuff I've been doing for a long time. And I want to be clear about it. I'm not saying Paul is wrong. I'm just saying Paul is Paul. Paul is not everyone. And when you have someone like Jesus to whom people are reacting, they're going to react in terms of their needs, their perceptions, their views of life. And I think we've been limited by the fact that we've had only Paul, because Paul doesn't talk to everyone. I'm going over the proofs right now of a book that I wrote on William James's Varieties of Religious Experience. And William James says, he taught psychology, philosophy, and anatomy at Harvard. He never taught religion. But William James says, religion has to fit your temperament. James talked about sick souls, not in a negative sense, but people who feel what the Germans call Weltschmerz, you know, the pain of the world. It's like Swedish movies. I saw this wonderful Swedish movie, the jacket said, a romantic comedy. Within 5 minutes, both parents of this guy were killed. I mean, at the end, he's dying. And if that's a comedy, what would a Swedish tragedy look like, you know? It's like going to an Ingmar Bergman movie, and he'll go out and look at a tree, and you want to just go commit suicide. Some people just have that. You know, whatever they see becomes transformed into this heavy drama, see? And then James talks about happy souls. You know, they just tend to sort of take life in stride, and they don't get knocked out of shape that way. They're not better or worse, they're different. James says, well, they have to have a different kind of religion, or they're going to see religion in a different way. Sick souls need to be converted. They need to feel their life is turned upside down. Healthy-minded souls don't. They never have a conversion, which is really rough if you're in a religion that tells you, you know, like some fundamentalisms, you got to have this personal conversion where you stand up and accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Poor Emily Dickinson. One of her teachers said she postponed her retirement, praying that Emily would have this experience. And Emily was very honest, said, I'm sorry, I've never had that. I've lived a long time as a somewhat Christian. I've never had that. You know, it's like in grade school. One guy comes back after seventh grade, he's grown 4 feet, and he's got hair all over him, you know, and others of us just grew a little bit. Okay. So certain souls need conversion. Certain souls don't. And if you don't, and you're in a group that's pressing you to come up and be converted, you're sitting there like, this isn't me, see? But if you're told that's the only way to be Christian, you're stuck, right? And it's interesting, when I talked on my Paul book, so many people, you know, said to me, you know, I never felt comfortable with Paul. These would often be 80-year-old ladies in Catholic parishes. And they'd say, I've never felt, well, no, because maybe that a different kind of soul. They saw a different side of Jesus, see? And that's why I'd like to recover these voices. Not because one is right and one is wrong, but because we need that multiplicity of voices, because no one voice can fully articulate this phenomenon that Jesus was. Does that make sense? So, you know, I try to be careful about that, because people think, oh, you want to get rid of Paul. No, I don't want to get rid of Paul. There's a lot I love about Paul. Okay? But I don't want Paul to be the only voice. Now, I've said recently that, you know, if you want to think about Christian theology, there are two things you have to make up your mind about. methodologically, that is to say, in terms of what method you're going to use, you have to decide how you read the Bible. If you read the Bible literally with a dogma of biblical inerrancy, as is done somewhere here in Wheaton, you get one kind of Christianity. Remember, a few years ago, one of their faculty converted to Roman Catholicism and was fired because the Catholic Church doesn't teach the dogma of biblical inerrancy. See, biblical inerrancy means they're God's words in the plural. And on the other side of the line, you have mainline churches and so on. And at the end of a reading, you'll often hear, this is the word of the Lord. What's the difference between the word and the words? The word means, here's a message for your spiritual life and growth. Words mean, these are the words. If you've got the words, there can be no change. In other words, you can't say the Bible's patriarchal, and it was kind of nasty to leave out the names of Jesus' sisters. I mean, if God said it, you gotta say, okay, that's your show. That's what you want. You don't like women? Okay, God, that's your business, see? And God seems to like slavery, okay, doesn't condemn it, and you know. But you know, if you take the Bible that way, I think you got several problems, you know. One, I think, unfortunately, you're an idolater. Because the essence of idolatry is to have more than one absolute, to take the relative as the absolute. Idolatry doesn't have to be idol, it can be an ideology. Nazism was idolatry. That's why Tillich condemned it. Well, I think fundamentalism is idolatry, because you've got God and an absolute Bible. Well, which one? Which absolute do you want? You don't get to have two. Secondly, you're saying that anything human beings have learned for 2,000 years is useless. I mean, why study at all? If we have God's words on everything, what more could we learn? And this, to me, is the tragedy of fundamentalism. So that's why I could never live on that side of the line. You live on the other side of the line, you say, yeah, this is inspired. But as the Vatican Council of the Catholic Church says, you know, these are human writers. They have economic, political biases. Don't blame them for not understanding life without slavery. I mean, 60% of the citizens of Hellenistic cities were slaves. Slavery for them was like electricity. They couldn't imagine life without it. But that's not because it's God's idea. It was just part of what was going on then. So on this side of the line, texts are, as I say, characterized by the three P's. They're partial, they can't say anything. They're provisional, you have to change them as situations change. And they're perspectival, which means men look at the world differently than women. And as long as everything was being written by men, that's the way it was. And when people tell me at a talk I did in Elmhurst, guy during the break said, the Bible's literally true. I said, what about all the contradictions? He said, there are no contradictions, just apparent ones. I said, okay, look, we got four teachings on divorce. In Mark, Jesus says, no divorce and remarriage. It's adultery. In Matthew, he says, a man can't divorce and remarry, except for porneia, which is the root of our word pornography, if your wife's sleeping around. In Luke, who lived in Hellenistic cities where women could initiate divorce, Jesus says, a man shall not and a woman shall not. And Paul kind of throws the whole thing out and says, well, if you got a pagan couple and one becomes a Christian, and the pagan partner is given that Christian grief, the Christian can divorce the pagan and marry a Christian. I mean, totally ignoring any teaching of Jesus. Now, you want to tell me those are apparent contradictions? No. Is one of them right and one of them wrong? No. I think they're all right, but each author is trying to understand Jesus in a different circumstance. Luke lives in Hellenistic cities where women can initiate divorce. Well, obviously, if Jesus is talking about divorce for him, it applies to women too. Here's a strange truth. You got to ponder this one, I think. To be faithful to the truth, you sometimes have to change the words. For example, the Christian creed says there are three persons in God. The word prosopon in Greek means a mask, something you put in front of your face. The word persona comes from the pipe the actor used. These are both stage images. God wears three masks. We know God as Father, we know God in Jesus, we know God as Spirit. Now, in modern English, we say there are three persons in God. But for us, person means personality, like Tom, Dick, and Harry. Well, that's heresy, see? You say, whoa, I'm using the same words. Yeah, but the words have changed. So to use the same words, or to get the same truth across, I now have to use different words. Gary Wills wrote a book on pursuit of happiness, a phrase used by our founding fathers just 200 years ago in English. And any time I ask students, what does it mean? Probably what you would say, you know, the right we have to pursue our happiness, do what we want to do, if it doesn't break the law. Gary Wills studied the libraries of the founding fathers. Pursuit of happiness meant freedom of religion. The people who came here wanted to be able to practice their religion as Baptists, Quakers. For them, that was pursuing happiness. We have no idea. We would use the same words and have no idea what they mean. So the whole point of this is that to carry a tradition along, of course, you often have to change the words. Or the context. What do I think Jesus' teaching would be on divorce today? Different from any of those. It would probably be the standard Jewish teaching of Shalom Habayit, namely, if there's no possibility of peace in the house, then a divorce is better. Well, then why did Jesus have such a strict teaching? Because of his concern for women. Divorced women didn't get alimony. They were just out on the street, and a woman was the possession of a man's home. A woman had to be in a man's home by sunset. Where did you go? Maybe you had a married brother who'd take you in, or a married son. Otherwise, you starved on the street or became a prostitute. Jesus taught a strict teaching on divorce. He told men, look, guys, you know, you get one shot at this, because Jesus didn't want to see a lot of women easily divorced and thrown out on the street. So if you take that variable out, you see, the whole teaching is different. And you know, that's why the study of Scripture is challenging. It's hard. And Vatican II says, you've got to know all those political, economic circumstances. Jesus is very rough on money. You know, rich can't get to heaven easier. Camel through the eye of a needle. Well, he lived in an occupied country. Right? Any Jews who were making money were in bed with the Romans. And so Jews making money were being unjust to their own people. The tax collectors, the Romans were smart enough. They didn't have Romans collect taxes. They had Jews collect taxes. And they were told, as long as you turn in your quota, the rest is yours. And they were notoriously greedy. So when Jesus comes to a town, remember Zacchaeus is in a tree, he's short, and he's a tax collector, and Jesus, who's always looking for a dinner, said, would you like to have me for dinner? Zacchaeus said, sure. And that night, they were all tax collectors, because no other Jews ate with them. And I wish we knew what Jesus said, we're not told, but at the end of the meal, Zacchaeus said, we're going to all give half of what we have to the poor. That didn't put Zacchaeus on the streets. He kept his house and his lifestyle. He could give away half and still be fine. So money meant a different thing in occupied countries. In Vichy, France, I love to use the examples I can't use with my college students. Well, some of you are too young, too. But, you know, that meant during the German occupation, if you were a Frenchman making money, you were collaborating with the Germans, say. Jesus lived in an occupied country. So, all of this tells us that getting to what's going on here isn't easy. If it's hard for us to figure out a text written in English in this country 200 years ago without doing some historical work, what's it like to go back 2,000 years into a totally different kind of culture, two translations removed from the language Jesus spoke? The Aramaic has gone to the Greek has gone to English, and think that we just pick it up. I mean, it's one of those things that gives me mild indigestion when one of my students says, but you know, you don't need to do any of that. You just pick up the Bible, and it's very clear always what it means. And I think, wow, you know? I guess we don't need all this study after all. See? It's very clear what it means. I wish it were so clear. So we need to recover these other voices. Now, what about James is different? James definitely knows about Paul. Nobody denies that. He picks the very text in Scripture that Paul picks, the text in Genesis that says Abraham was made God-centered by his faith. God-centered is the way I translate that word tzedek in Hebrew, which comes out sometimes as righteous in English. In translating, I follow the rules of Luther, one of the great translators. Luther walked around the marketplace in the morning, heard how people spoke, then did his translation. And when I'm doing my translations, I grab students and pull them in my office and I say, how does this sound to you? And if they say, I don't think I could ever say anything like that. Okay? I think a translation should sound like this was said yesterday. Okay? So I'm not going to use the word righteous. Okay? I have to make up a word, God-centered, because tzedek means centered in God, with a right relation to God. Or you'll read justified, so you're justified by faith. That has nothing to do with justice, paying a fair wage. It's like when you justify a margin. It means to be in a right relation. But who's going to figure that out? See? So that's the part of translation that is really difficult. So Paul is saying Abraham was God-centered by his faith. And James happens to pick that very one passage out of Scripture and says, oh, Abraham, he was made righteous by his works. Now, what do we have here? A contradiction? Two religions? None of that. What we have is two aspects of religion. We call it cognitive and performative. Cognitive is how you think and believe. Performative is what you do. So I always say religion transforms your consciousness. That's how you see the world. Your conscience, that's how you act in the world. And your sense of community. Because we tend, you know, to gather with people who have similar interests. So, you know, people who want to do heavy drugs tonight probably aren't here with us. Although I haven't checked out the refreshments, they're usually not included, you see. So, you know, we all know that in any, you know, at the college, you know. Druggies hang out with druggies, drinkers with drinkers, theater people with theater people. You know, it's very natural. So sometimes when you change your mind about who you are, you change your community. Many people in AA have told me, I had to turn my whole life around. I always hung around with people at hour and a half cocktail parties. I don't want to sip my ginger ale for an hour and a half and watch all these people get sloshed. So to put this in Christian language, and this alone would make me like Paul, I love his phrase, put on the mind of Christ. Okay? The Buddhists call it the Buddha mind. You know, every tradition has a name for it. There's big mind and there's little mind. If your religion is working for you, you'll notice that you're getting a bigger mind. You're seeing the world with a bigger mind. And the Christian term is the mind of Christ. See? Now, Paul stressed the cognitive a lot because he was Greek. See? I mean, Greek was his first language. Greeks tend to ideas, essences. They tend to live above the eyebrows. One thing I noted when I did my book on Paul, he never once refers to an experience in the physical world. He lived in some of those beautiful places on earth, you know, Corinth and Ephesus, gorgeous cities. And he never says, I saw a great sunrise in Corinth or had a great bottle of wine in Ephesus. Jesus, however, will say, oh, you know, blown out of my socks. Look at that field of wildflowers. Solomon wasn't, you know, Jesus, his first language was Aramaic. Semitic languages tell stories. Metaphors, see? The book I wrote on unpacking the parables, Jesus taught in parables. Parables are metaphors, see? The Semitic genius is story. Mashal in Hebrew can mean a parable, a proverb, an anecdote, an allegory. It means the closest you get to the great truths is through a metaphor. You can't get there through ordinary language. So if Jesus was a carpenter and you asked him how to make a door frame, he wouldn't have said, you know, 10 birds flew into a wood, and he'd have just said, you take the wood and you do this, because you can talk about making a door frame in ordinary language. But when people said, what's the kingdom of God like? Jesus said, well, it's like a mustard seed. It's like a woman putting yeast in dough. It's like finding a treasure. Why? Why did Jesus all of a sudden fall into poetry? Why didn't he tell us about the kingdom just the way he can tell us about a door frame? Because it's not the same. Okay? The realm of mystery is not the same as the realm of problem. Karen Armstrong calls it the realm of logos, technology, and a door frame is logos, and the realm of mythos. So when you're talking about mystery, you need the two other M words. You need myth, which is something true, but it didn't happen. And you need mystical consciousness. And those three words have as their root M-U in Greek, M-Y in English, which means to be silent, mu. What has to be silent? The rational mind. Okay? The mind that can understand the doorframe, or understand building a rocket, or understand any aspect of technology, is not the mind that can understand holiness, existence, the nature of God. These can only be understood through metaphor. Or they're not understood exactly, but the closest we can get to them is metaphor. And Jesus was a master of metaphor. And that's because it was his tradition. That's the Jewish tradition. That's the Semitic tradition. You know, if you read Plato's Republic, how he goes on page after page defining justice, do you know that in the entire Hebrew Bible, the entire New Testament, and the entire Quran, there are no definitions? When Semitic languages talk about justice, as James does, in the first chapter, he says, what is religion? Take care of the orphans and the widows. See that? That's Semitic. That's performative. You see the difference? Okay. Greeks want an essence. Anytime you see the word, a word that ends in L-O-G-Y, see, that's Greek. Biology, geology, theology. See? In a technical sense, Jews and Muslims don't do theology. But because they talk to Christians, they learn to do theology. Christians do theology because we started out in Greek, see? Christians have creeds. We read creeds in churches. Judaism never produced a creed. Finally, poor Maimonides, the greatest Jewish philosopher, living in southern Spain, talking to all these Muslims and Christians during the good days when this could happen, my view is he had so many Christians harping on him all the time, you don't have a creed, you don't have a creed. One day, Maimonides sat down and wrote a creed, and nobody's ever paid any attention to it in Judaism. But he did it because Christians wanted a creed. He said, okay, I can write a creed. But you talk to any Jew about saying a creed in a synagogue, it just sounds bizarre to stand up and recite what you believe. But it's very Greek, you see. But when James talks about religion, he doesn't say it's what you believe. He said, what you do. Well, he was like his brother. See, I don't know how all these fundamentalists who think faith is what it's all about can manage to quote Jesus when he said, well, all you're going to be judged on in the end, honey, is I was hungry and you fed me, thirsty you gave me to drink. That's what it's all about. And he never asked you what your religion is or why, you know, that's what it's all about. That sounds a lot like this guy. And in the Quran, God says straight out, you won't be judged on your theology. You'll be judged on how you worked to create a world of justice and peace. And when Muhammad talks about justice in the hadith are almost funny. They said, Muhammad said this so much that we all knew it. Muhammad said, whatever you have in excess belongs to the poor. See how Semitic that is? He doesn't give you a definition of justice. And Muhammad passes a guy with 12 camels, and he said, you know, that guy down the road just had a real bad crop. He could use a camel, and you probably don't need 12. See? That's Semitic. I heard Ibu Patel speak, the head of the Interfaith Youth Corps, Indian Muslim. He spoke for an hour about interfaith dialogue and never once enunciated a definition or a conceptual structure. Now, I'm much more Greek. If I talked about interfaith dialogue, you'd get a conceptual structure because my training is Greek. Now, Patel has a PhD from Oxford. He could do that, but it's not what he instinctively does. Do you see what I'm saying? Elie Wiesel, I hear him whenever I can. He tells stories. Why? Because he's too dumb to quote a syllogism? No, because he's Semitic. That's how he talks, see? You know, it's sort of a tangent, but it amuses me when people think we think whatever we think. Oh, no, we think within the bounds of our language and our culture. See, in Greek, you're two, a body and a soul. So for Plato, when you die, soul goes to heaven, body goes to the tomb. In ancient Hebrew, there was no word for a soul, for a separate soul. Their view of human being was holistic. So when Jews started to think about life after death, what was it? That clumsy idea, resurrection of the body. Because Jews couldn't think about anything being you if there wasn't a body. And poor Paul, who knows Greek and Hebrew, tries to put it together and says, well, it's a body, but it's a spiritual body. There's an oxymoron for you. We can only think what our language allows us to think. We wouldn't have our universities without Plato. We wouldn't have a laboratory without Aristotle. He was a marine biologist. He invented the scientific method. So we don't think whatever we want to think. We think what our language and our culture allows us to think. And that's why translation is important. And that's why it's tricky, see? Because when you translate, you can't always make that jump. See? Probably a lot of you know that saying of Jesus, what does it profit you to gain the whole world and lose? What? Your soul. Right? And fundamentalists I talked to, something about going to hell. That's fine, except Jesus couldn't have said it. He didn't have a word for a separate soul. So in my translation, and it's certainly not perfect, I have Jesus say, what does it profit you to gain the whole world if you lose the essence of what you are? Right? In Hebrew, it's a dimension of what you are. In ancient Hebrew, modern Hebrew, it's like us. It's like English or Greek. So James has a performative understanding of religion, as does Jesus. Jesus doesn't teach creeds. He doesn't say that being whole has something to do with what you believe. The Greek word for believe is like a proposition. I believe there are three persons in God. The Hebrew word emunah is trust. Trust. What do you trust? See? So I think we need James to balance Paul and all these Greek writers. In all the polls that are taken in the United States, the vast majority of Americans define religion as a belief system. Okay? We're essentially Greek. You know, when you go to Athens or something, or you know your home, there's something there that's familiar. Whereas when I go to the temple of Karnak in Egypt, it's magnificent, but nothing in Karnak connects with me. Okay? Many people say, if you want to understand our Western civilization, you have to know the Greeks. You got to know Plato and Aristotle. Whitehead said, all subsequent philosophy, it's just footnotes to Plato and Aristotle. Secondly, you have to know the Bible, because the Bible lives in all our literature and language. You know, we have Good Samaritan laws and so it's just thick with it. And you have to know Shakespeare. If you know those three, you know who we are, see? But Greek and Hebrew are very different. So the fact that Christianity put its sacred text in Greek, well, I mean, it's one of those things. It gave us a problem, it gave us an opportunity, depending on how you look at it. And this is going to sound kind of snobby and elitist, but I'm going to say it anyhow. When I get on these radio shows and some fundamentalist calls in and says, I have a verse of scripture here, and I say, no, you don't. You have a translation of a verse of scripture, unless you're reading me the Greek. See? And I don't do that to be snobbish. I do that because I believe it. I believe that an English translation of a Greek text is not the text. One of the reasons I don't like to teach about Islam is I don't know Arabic. I don't like to teach a text I don't know in the original. Because it's like these new gospels are in Coptic. I don't know Coptic, right? And I'm so uncomfortable because right when I want to get in there and pull that word out and see what it means, I can't. I don't know the language. So no, the King James Version of the Bible, pardon me, is not the Bible. It's a translation. And I don't think even fundamentalism teaches that the translators of the King James Version of the Bible were inspired by God. Okay, so why James? Because it's the other half of Christianity. It's the other half of religion. Crossan put it together for me in a very simple way with a tiny little mark called a hyphen. Battles, books have been written for centuries. Are we saved by works? Are we saved by faith? Are we saved by works? And hyphen just, Crossan said, write it, faith, hyphen, works. Stop making the two fight. Obviously, if you do works and they're phony and hypocritical, they're of no use. But also, if you have faith and nothing happens, that's of no use. I mean, James, you know, those of you who've heard me know that I think there's a lot of humor in Jesus' teaching. Well, I think it runs in the family because, you know, James says it too. He says, you believe in the devil? He said, you believe in God? He said, that's nice. So do the demons in hell. The demons in hell believe in God. So if belief in God is what saved us, they should be saved. James says, you have faith? That's nice. So you walk by your brother who needs food and so on, and you say, have a good day. Does that do it? See, why James? So many reasons. One, how can I put together the fact that we have a lot of people in this country who call themselves Jews, Christians, Muslims, right? And all of our religions tell us, religion's about taking care of the poor. The Bible has 30,000 verses saying, take care of the poor. And yet, we have one of the worst records of any country for taking care of the sick and the poor. My Canadian students say, oh my God, you know, you guys really don't seem to have a clue. Why? Because I think 99% of Christians, Jews, well, especially Christians, think, if I've got the right faith, I've got it, that's it. But they've only got half. I was talking in a church once, Catholic church, that has a Vincent de Paul box. This is a group, mostly of retired guys, who are a marvelous group of people who take care of all the needs of people in the parish who are poor, who need anything. Say, anytime somebody needs something, I go to Vincent de Paul and say, hey, take care of this guy. They do it. So some churches have prayers of the faithful, right? The prayer of the faithful. Someone said, oh God, you know, for all the poor in Illinois, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. And then, okay, that's done for today. You know, but I said, it's half done. Now put in that box as much as you can. Because otherwise, that faith is of no use. Okay? Don't give me works without faith. Don't give me hypocritical works. But don't give me faith without works. Okay? We got to walk our talk. Okay? And this notion that if you believe a certain thing, you get to heaven, the notion that God is so small-minded that he's got this little code, and if you get the code right, I just can't see how people could put their mind around something like that, you know? It's a more demanding package than that. See? Jesus tells a story of a guy who had two sons, and he said, sons, I need some help in the field today. One kid said, sure, Dad, I'll help. The other kid said, Dad, I'm busy. But the one who said, I'll help, didn't go. And the one who said, he's busy, went. Who is the son? Okay, I'll be a bit heretical. I think many atheists I know are better Christians than many Christians I know, if you believe this. Okay. But if you think it's getting the code right, no, then, you know, then those Christians have, they got the code. Okay. But, you know, if God just wants codes, I'm not particularly interested. I think I got in that habit from grade school when the nuns told us that, you know, you went to heaven, you sat on a cloud with a harp and sang praises to God for all eternity. Even in fourth grade, I kind of wanted to check out hell because I don't have a singing voice, and the thought of sitting on a cloud forever singing song sounded like the most hellish thing imaginable, say. So if God is really some kind of a trickster who's looking for a code, I'm not particularly interested in that kind of God. You know? If God doesn't read the heart, then what kind of God is that? And isn't it cherry-picking anyhow? I mean, when I get the one text, I say, okay, first letter of John. God is love. Whoever abides in love abides in God. Can't atheists abide in love? And agnostics and even members of the Theosophical Society. You see what I mean? It doesn't sound to me like abiding in love is restricted to a certain membership. So I think we need James, not because James is right and Paul is wrong, but because James is James and Paul is Paul. And the more voices we hear, the more richly articulated our understanding of Jesus is. Does that make some sense? But, you know, it's hard. As much as I say this, people will say to me, oh, you want to say Paul is wrong and Thomas is right? No. I mean, I guess it comes from that notion that, you know, if this is true, this has to be false. Instead of understanding the idea of a richly textured truth that is contributed to by a variety of voices. I mean, I think we see a richer portrait of Jesus. And again, I'd want to stress the fact that people heard Jesus according to their needs and their sense of reality. You know, if they were really down and felt terrible about themselves, you know, they heard that compassion and forgiveness. If they were full of energy and so on, they heard that zeal, you know, to go out and do your good works. I mean, you know, you hear, who was it, one of the Wesleys who said, what speaks to your soul, hey? It's got to speak to your soul. And our souls aren't always the same. I mean, even our soul isn't the same every day or every year or every moment of our life. Hey? So I think it's time for questions. I don't know how much time we have. So just throw the net over me when it's time. We can stretch. Do you want to stretch?
We can take a short break, and when we come back, we can hear the multiplicity of your voices.
Yes.
formulate your questions, and we'll be back shortly.
All right.
With apologies that I can't quote verse and chapter, but James is writing a letter back to the Church of Jerusalem, and he addresses it to the elders and to James, or I'm sorry, Paul.
He addresses it to the 12 tribes in the diaspora. And that's something I didn't say. I think this letter is quite early, see. James knows trouble is coming. One of the last things Jesus said in Jerusalem before his arrest was, he was basically saying, don't fight the Romans militarily, but don't capitulate to the empire of Caesar. Live your life with God. Let the Romans be. The same thing Jeremiah said at the time of the Babylonian Empire. Don't fight. Well, James certainly knew. And Jesus said, if you don't, within this generation, there's going to be destruction. Generation is 40 years. See? In the year 70, Jerusalem and the temple were destroyed by the Romans. Because when Jesus died in 30, the zealots, who were the freedom fighters, started getting more and more power. Now, James is watching this in Jerusalem. He knows what his brother said. He knows that the zealots are not leading the Jews in a good direction. And I think he knew trouble was coming. Because it starts out talking about persecution and so on. He knows trouble is coming. And he says, you know, get ready for this persecution. I think that's what motivated him. But he's in Jerusalem, I think, and he's writing it, maybe around 60. I mean, well, it's come. What kept the high priest in check was the Roman governor. The high priest was appointed by Rome. So the high priest had a Roman mind in a certain way. The governor died, I think, in 62. In those days, it took 2 years probably to get another governor there. I mean, word had to get to Rome. Depending on the weather, that could take a year. Then the emperor had to appoint a new governor. That guy had to pack his stuff up and get to Jerusalem. This could take 2-3 years. See? And the Jewish historian Josephus says the high priest, who was a particularly vicious kind of guy, took that opportunity to get rid of his enemies. Because under normal circumstances, the Jewish authority couldn't execute people without the governor. See? And by the way, the high priest, Annas, was the son of the Annas in the New Testament. And his son-in-law is Caiaphas, the high priest at the time of Jesus' death. That Annas had one son-in-law and three sons who became high priests. He was a political animal. And Josephus says among the good people he had killed was James, the brother of Jesus. And he's a Jewish historian. He said, you know, all the decent people in Jerusalem really mourned the loss of James because they knew he was a good man. So the letter had to be written. Sometimes, to see if my students are awake, I'll say, the consensus of scholars is that James wrote this letter before his death. And only about half notice anything, I think. Some write it in their notes, you know. But as a teacher, it humbles you to realize, Ben said today, you know, about half of my students were playing with some kind of machine while I was talking about Merton, but it's humbling. At any rate, so James is early, I mean, very close to the letters of Paul. And he actually knew Jesus. He grew up with him. He quotes Jesus all the time. And yet he never talks about anything like this sinful nature. Jews and Muslims say human nature is good, but weak. We need help. Paul has a particularly dark view of human nature. And I think it's said at the beginning, if you're going to do theology, the two most important questions are methodologically, how do I read the Bible? And ontologically, in terms of being, how do I see human nature? Because as a Christian theologian, the way you see human nature will be then the way you see Jesus. See? If we're just totally evil and corrupt and so on, Jesus is the fixer. He's the redeemer. If you have a more optimistic view of human nature, Jesus is a reminder, a helper, a teacher. So to the church. If you have this totally depraved view of human nature, then human beings need strict authority to keep them in line all the time because you can't trust them. They're evil. In fact, I was saying at dinner, your view of human nature will give you your view of parenting, of education, of politics, pretty much everything else you think about will be consciously or unconsciously guided by the way you see human nature. Now, Christian theologians span out on a quiz I just gave my students. They had to put a set of names in order. See? The most pessimistic view, Jonathan Edwards, sinners in the hands of an angry God. We're all ugly bugs that deserve it. Okay, then Augustine, then Paul, then Teresa of Avila, and Father Thomas Keating, who's a monk in Snowmass, Colorado today. Keating says in his books, and I don't know why Rome hasn't burned him at the stake, maybe because he's an 88-year-old Trappist, for God's sake. He says, original sin is human nature. We're good, but we need to grow up spiritually just like we grow up physically. We have to toddle and walk and run. We're not born enlightened, but we're good, see? Now, when I was a kid, an unbaptized child was called a child of Satan. The Catholic baptismal rite included an exorcism. The priest blew on the child and said, depart Satan. Vatican II dropped that. And Catholic theology no longer teaches that an unbaptized child is a child of Satan. See? There's been an evolution in the understanding of human nature. At least there was through John the 23rd. Pope John the 23rd, I think, had a healthy sense of human nature. And it's been downhill ever since. I heard Paul the 6th. He didn't have that trust that John the 23rd did. John Paul II, as a Jesuit friend of mine in Rome said, he is the best of the commissars. He reflected the communist mentality. And the current pope, I think, the best of the commandants. That's German organization. So how you think about human nature, that's going to determine your whole theology. So anyhow, we're talking about the address of the letter, but it's important to know to whom something is written. I think James sees trouble coming and is talking to the Jewish Christians wherever they are.
Hi, Ron. Hi. When I do go into the New Testament, which isn't very often, but I do look for concrete terms. Now, if James was a brother of Christ, and they were of the house of David, would that have given him a certain status in Jerusalem during that time?
Well, there's certainly more in one view, but see, I don't think he was of the house of David literally. See, again, I don't think Jesus was born in Bethlehem. I think that's Midrash, because Bethlehem is where David was born. See? So it's symbolically important that Jesus be linked to David. So when Matthew gives his genealogy, he says, there were 14 generations from here to here, 14 from here to here, 14 from here to here. Well, every Hebrew letter is a number. See? Whoever Matthew was, he was a Jewish scribe. He knew he quotes the Hebrew scripture about 100 times, and he knows numerology. See? So every name is a number. And the word David equals 14. So when he said 14, 14, 14, that's three times David. That's the Messiah, see? When he tells a story of Jesus being born in Bethlehem, I think that's symbolic. By this time, I don't think, Jews really knew much about their genealogy because of all these destructive wars. See? You have to read, one of my best scripture scholars said, never take numbers literally. See? 40 is like complete. The Hebrew people wandered 40 years. Jesus was 40 days in the desert. 7 is good. I always say, when we get to Protestantism, Catholics have 7 sacraments, Protestant 2. Argument's over. Catholics are right. 2 is never the right answer in the Bible. It doesn't work. 7 gifts of the Spirit, you have to have 7 sacraments. It's that simple. I mean, I'm just kidding about that, but in a sense, I'm not. I have a former student. He's a bank teller in Evanston. He says, Ron, I said, this rabbi comes to me all the time with checks from the synagogue, and they're always in multiple, you know, like 18, multiples of 18. He said, why don't Jews write checks for 20? I said, chai in Hebrew, the word for life, is 18. So usually for bar, bat, mitzvah, anything, you give gifts of 18. When Laura Bernstein and I wrote our book, it has 36 chapters. The editor said, why not 35? We said, no, we're not going to explain it to you. Keep 36. Okay? I mean, not every reader gets it, but for those who do, it's there. See? So anyhow, you know, there are those who say, maybe they did remember this, but a peasant family in Nazareth, I doubt it. You see, again, I'm not picking on fundamentalists for sure, but the problem with fundamentalism is it's so profoundly wrong. It reads the Bible as though it's front page reporting. And the Bible has all these different genres. I mentioned the mashal, you know, parables, proverbs. And then there's midrash. That's when you take a verse of scripture and you kind of build a moral lesson around it. It's not meant to be historical. So a lot of these stories, like the virgin birth and so on, are midrash. They're telling you something true, but not something factual. They're not writing about gynecology. They're writing in a symbolic way. Okay? But the fundamentalist reads the Bible like front page reporting. And therefore gets everything wrong, because when the German scholars came up with all the possible genres that are in the Bible, the only one that is not there is history. There's not one verse of history. The closest you have is what the Germans called Heilsgeschichte, sacred history. They'll look at a historical person from the viewpoint of how he kept the covenant with God. See? But there's not one line of history in the Bible. And yet fundamentalists read the whole Bible as though it were history. Isn't that amazing? See, that's why I said, you know, I think in an earlier talk here, the challenge to Judaism today, assimilation. The challenge to Islam, modernization. The challenge to Christianity, polarization. Down in Naples, Florida, I was invited to a dinner with Bishop Spong. We talked about this. He said, how do you get all of this under one umbrella? You see? When I talk to a fundamentalist Christian, it's so much more foreign to me than most Jews and Muslims and Buddhists I know. It's much more foreign. Or I should put it this way, a fundamentalist form of Judaism or Islam, you know, it's not so much what religion you are, it's how you construct that theology, see? And boy, the way you read a text makes such a difference. So, I think we can say there's a little historical background about the book, but it's very much like Jesus. He talks about wisdom, pursuing wisdom. See, nowhere does he talk about Jesus saving death or being saved through the blood of Jesus or anything. I think James is more like his brother. We're good and we're reminded of who we are by these teachings, as we reflect on these teachings. Ignatius of Loyola, the founder of the Jesuits, said, one verse of scripture, if you grasp it, is enough to make you a saint. So people shouldn't be kind of arguing about the Bible in a sense or trying to prove it factually true, but asking what it means. See, what does this mean? What does this mean for my life? Not where is the ark today? Let's go look for it. But what does that whole story mean? See? Where is your ark? The word ark in Hebrew is the same as the word for the ark in the synagogue that holds the Torah scrolls. Is that a Jewish ark in a world of violence? And in churches, the main part is called the nave, from novice, the word for ship. Is that a Christian ark? See, it's kind of like, this is a violent world. Where is your ark? Where is life being preserved? One of the beautiful things about so many young people is so many seeking careers in environment, see? Because a word has come into our language that wasn't there when I was a kid. Sustainability. Can we live the way we live and keep doing it? And for how long? Right? Isn't that the story of the ark? Right? So, you know, it becomes a wonderfully rich story unless you get bogged down in thinking of a boat that you had to get all these animals into. See, then it just becomes a trick. And when Kevin Roos, who wrote that book, he went to Jerry Falwell's college, he said they spent hours in class talking about how they got the animals in. And because they teach a short earth theory, dinosaurs were contemporaries, and the teachers taught that they were little dinosaurs. And when they were all in the ark, God put them into a kind of hibernation sleep for 40 days. I mean, they have to tell us how the whole story works literally. And when you're through with all of that, what new meaning do you have for your life? How has your life been changed now that you find out the dinosaurs were little or that they were sleeping? See? So when you look to the Bible for facts, you just get a handful of dust. It's no more interesting than the day's newspaper. But when you look to it for meaning, you've got an eternal task ahead of you. Think if you were a rabbi, okay? Every year, the whole Torah is read, and you've got to get a sermon on that portion. That began about 500 BCE when Ezra brought the Torah to Jerusalem. So you're a new rabbi. For 2,500 years, the community has read this text, and some of the brightest folks around have talked about it. And now it's your turn. How are you going to find something new to say? Well, because it's like the ocean. You never will probe its depths. But if it's just facts, it's like the newspaper. Would you like to talk about the same article in the newspaper for 2,500 years? Yeah.
In the Bible, fundamentalists a lot of times talk about questioning the I am, because they go, because I was raised Methodist, but sometimes things just didn't make sense growing up. When Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life, but in Exodus, when Moses talked to God, God said, He was I am.
See, so here again
wait,
is...
Wait just a second. So okay. When Jesus was saying, I am, wasn't Jesus talking about God, not himself?
First, let me tell you a little secret about Hebrew. You can't say I am. There's no present tense of the verb to be. So God didn't say it in Exodus, neither did Jesus. You can't say it. If I want to say I am Ron, I say Ani, Ron. See, the Jews wisely understood, you don't need the present tense of the verb to be. What Exodus says is, eyah, esher, eyah. In terms of tense, it's a future, see? I'll be what I will be. I'll do what I will do. I'll be there. You'll know me when I'm there. See, I'm a God of action. You'll know when I'm around. I'll be with you. You'll know I'm there. Now, the Greeks read it. Where do the Greeks live? Above the eyebrows. God would say, I am an eternal being. Jews would never, I mean, they couldn't even say it. They don't have words to say it. Now, John's gospel, let me just say this simply. The persona of Jesus in John's gospel is not the historical Jesus. You can't do it unless he was totally schizophrenic. In Mark and Matthew and Luke, Jesus doesn't talk about himself. Somebody says, good master, what shall I do? He says, don't call me good, only God is good. And in John's gospel, he goes on for pages in this Greek rhetoric, see? The persona of Jesus in John is the faith of that community. See? Jesus doesn't tell one parable in John, but we're told he taught everything in parables. Why? Because in John, Jesus is the parable of God. So you have to read John's gospel a totally different way. It's like a series. All those signs are like little mini dramas. I mean, get a little acting group to act them out. They're beautiful little dramas. You have protagonists. You've always got the guy who doesn't understand, which makes the story fun. Nicodemus says, oh, are we supposed to go in our mother's womb again? You know. or at the wedding feast, the sommelier says, well, usually you save the good wine, you know, serve it first. You've always got, like in a Shakespeare play, you got the dumb guy that doesn't get it, and it makes the audience feel good because we know what he doesn't. These are carefully crafted little dramas, see? But it's not the historical Jesus being remembered there, see? It's the faith of the community. And it's a beautiful faith of a Jesus through whom the divine breaks through so strongly, see? But Jesus couldn't have said, I am. I mean, and if he did, no one would have known what he was talking about. They weren't Greek philosophers. They were interested in performative. They'd have said, that's not Jesus. What do you do? Hey? They're not interested in these endless discourses about essences. Only Greeks get interested in that. Jews get bored immediately and want to know what we're doing here. So to have Jesus, I mean, imagine the Last Supper, 14 pages of Jesus going on about his essence. They'd have all been sound asleep. What is this guy going to say? Something real, see? The Bible is a tricky book, you know? I mean, when I teach the Reformation, I mean, there's some neat things about it, but the one thing they really got wrong was, well, let's get rid of, you know, authority and give everybody a Bible, and they'll all be reading the same thing and understanding the same thing. That was pretty naive, as history has proved. It's hard to get two people to agree. You're never going to get agreement by reading the same book. So, John is, you know, again, don't misunderstand me. John is beautiful for many reasons. I see it as kind of a poem of faith. And the Jesus in John is the faith of a group of Christians who were very Greek. We know that because they have to be told everything. Like the gospel will say, and they called him rabbi, that means teacher. Yeah, you don't have to tell most people rabbi means teacher. So you got people who know nothing about Judaism anymore. For in John's gospel, Jesus isn't even Jewish anymore. Yeah? The disciples are hiding in the upper room for fear of the Jews. Who were they? Martians? I mean, where did they come? They were Jews too. But for John's community, Jews are now the other. Jesus isn't really a Jew. Jesus says to the Jewish leaders, you know, your father is Satan. I mean, John has some dangerous ideas. Genesis says everybody is a child of God. John's gospel says if you believe in Jesus, you're a child of God. See, John's gospel is the one fundamentalists like because it's exclusivist. It sends everybody to hell. See, Elaine Pagels believes that John's gospel was written partially to counterattack Thomas. Because Thomas is saying, you're all words of God spoken into the world. See? And John, only Jesus is. You got to believe in, nobody else is a word of God. See? So John's gospel is very exclusive. It's a very exclusivist community. It's a very tricky text. I don't know if I'll ever write a book on John's gospel. Yeah. You need it.
You just mentioned Ellen Pagel, and I'm really curious to know what you think is the validity of the works like the Gospel of Philip or the Gospel of Thomas in terms of what the real historical Jesus taught.
Well, I mean, it's... You know, I teach this course on historical Jesus. It's hard to reconstruct a piece of history from 50 years ago. Given 2,000 years ago that Jesus never wrote, that he only lived 3 years, I think we've got enough to get a sense of his voice and, you know, what he was saying, his basic message and so on. But, you know, it's not that we have nothing, but we don't have as much as some people think. I think we have enough. I mean, I think from the parables and the basic teachings, you can get a sense of what Jesus was about. But Thomas, I think, is has something. I think parts of Thomas are earlier than the canonical Gospels. So I put Thomas in a separate class. Elaine Pagel spoke in Lake Forest a few weeks ago. She said, don't call Thomas Gnostic. He's not really Gnostic. These other Gospels, I'm teaching like Gospel of Judas now, Gospel of Mary Magdalene, they're later. Now, is there no memory of the historical Jesus there? It's hard to say. You know, it all depends on how the cut was made, and the bishops didn't tell us. I always find it kind of ironic that some Protestants put so much faith in the Bible, which was the result of a committee of Catholic bishops. You know? And there are some things we notice. No Gospels in which Christians call each other brother and sister and don't reflect a hierarchy are accepted. No Gospels in which women have a place and authority are accepted. Might that have something to do with these guys all being supposedly celibate men? So how was a cut made? See? A lot of Christians think Christians had the New Testament in their pocket, you know, by the year 50. You know the first time anybody gave a list of the 27 books we have? Athanasius in 367, and that was only to the churches in Egypt, and he said, these are the 27 books in the canon. I want you to destroy all the others. And the monks who didn't want to do that, they buried the books, and that's why we're finding them. And they didn't dig them up because Athanasius said, in a good Christian manner, any of you who keep them, the imperial soldiers are coming and you will be killed. That's 367. That's Egypt. The debates still go on to about 389. So it's a long time to get a New Testament. See, that's why when you say, what's the central connecting link to God for Jews? The Torah. For Muslims, the Quran. For Christians, the person of Jesus. Because there was no New Testament till around 400. So that couldn't have been the essence of being a Christian. It took 400 years for Catholic bishops to give us the authoritative book for Protestants. Something about that story sounds strange.
Do you have two or three or four translations that you recommend? Or
for the Bible, I would say the one used in all scholarly work is the New Revised Standard Version, NRSV. It's like the great-grandson of the King James, except it corrected. King James had a lot of mistakes in it. They didn't look as much about Hebrew and Greek then. So there was one version and then another, and now this one. It's not as poetic as the King James. One of our English teachers who just passed away could never forgive me, you know, for not using the King James. I mean, if you love Shakespeare, you got to love it. See? But if you want anybody to understand it, you know, they don't quite know what it means, suffer the little children to come unto me. You know? It's not language my students would understand. But it is beautiful. If you want poetry, the King James is a masterpiece. If you want something close to the original meaning, Revised Standard Version. Watch the versions that come out of fundamentalist circles. They'll take a word like arsenikoitai, which probably means male prostitute, and translate it as homosexuals, because they have an anti-gay agenda, even though the concept of homosexuality didn't enter Western consciousness till the 19th century. There was no word in any language for all same-sex behavior acts. But, you know, if people have an axe to grind and they're translating, that's how they do it. I was put on this talk show with a minister at Colorado Springs to talk about homosexuality. Okay? And I said, well, why don't you start? Where do you want to begin? He says, begin. What do you mean? He said, it's straight out there. It's condemned. I said, do you have the text with you? He said, yeah, King James. I said, no, the Greek. He said, I don't think we need to be intellectuals here. I said, if you don't have the Greek, we can't have this conversation. You're giving me a translation that is unwarranted, unacceptable. There is no justification for using a 20th century concept to translate something that meant some form of same-sex behavior, probably male prostitution. Okay? So again, I'm not trying to be pedantic. I mean, imagine someone who said he or she was a great Shakespeare scholar, but they only read Shakespeare in French translation. Could you ever take them seriously? Could anyone be a great Shakespeare scholar who couldn't read Shakespeare in English? I mean, you know, I was talking to our French teacher, a Spanish teacher yesterday, and he said, you know, he said, and his wife is Portuguese, and he knows a bunch of languages. He just says, you know, he said, we Americans, we just don't get this language thing. He said, it's probably because, you know, we got a big country. Anywhere you go, you usually find somebody who speaks English. And we don't get the fact that every language, as Max Müller said, is a petrified philosophy. And when you change something from one language to another, you're not just changing a word here. You're like, you take nefesh in Hebrew, which is a dimension of one being, you say psuche, and it's a separate entity. For the Greeks, we're two things. Plato says, like rider and horse. See? So when you die, the psuche goes to heaven. The soul goes to heaven, and the body goes to the earth. Jews had no language to say that in. Just like God couldn't say I am to a Jew. There's no word in Hebrew for I am. It doesn't exist. See, it's in these matters, it's not, but when you're talking about a text, you've got to read it in the linguistic philosophical context, you know? And just the way it is.
Any more questions?
Helen Keller said, learn Greek so you could read Homer. And if she did it, you know, I tell my students, I don't know why they can't do it. I only have one student in my Greek tutorial right now, so it tells you how persuasive I am. Anything else?
Well, thank you so much, Ron.
Thank you. And hopefully, I hope to finish that book this summer. The book on the parables and William James should be out by May. And my son does everything on this Facebook thing and website. In one of my books, I say, I feel like an old monk brought out of the scriptorium who's been writing manuscripts all his life, and he's led into this strange building where this machine is belching out printed pages, and someone tells him it's a printing press. You know, imagine that. And when I talk to my son, who lives in, I say, he inhabits a world as a native that I visit occasionally only as a stranger. When he does computer talk about things, I feel like that, you know? He says, Dad, we don't put up signs anymore, you know? He said, we're working on your Facebook page. Say. And he just tells him what to do. Dad, give me a story, give me this. Answer those comments, Dad, you know? And I just do whatever he says. So anyhow, he does a good job, And so if you go to ronmillersworld.org, that takes you everywhere else. And that's that world. And I go back to my scriptorium, my world of books. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.